India is helping many African countries at a time of global pandemic. With me is the Indian envoy to Kenya to talk about how India is reaching out to Kenya, where there are a number of Indians also present. So welcome to Vyond. My first question to you is an obvious question. How are India and Kenya cooperating when it comes to this pandemic, fighting this pandemic?
Firstly, thank you, Siddhant, for having me on your show. It's a pleasure to be on. Just in the context of your question, Dr. Jaishankar, our foreign minister, spoke to the foreign minister of Kenya, Madam Omamo, Ambassador Omamo, just last week. And during the course of that call, they discussed about how India is showing its solidarity, as you mentioned, to all the African countries and to find a way of working forward. And in that conversation itself, CS Madam Omamo, the Cabinet Secretary, requested Dr. Jaishankar for a relaxation on the export ban of hydroxychloroquine. And that was granted on the spot by Dr. Jaishankar. So they were very much appreciative of that. In addition, we are also running what are called e-iTech courses. You know, this is at the moment we had a very short notice, but we still managed to get 5 Kenyans to register for those courses. They're especially meant for healthcare professionals. And this is training on COVID-19. So it's extremely timely. And this is just the first of the courses, and we are hoping to have many more courses coming up, and we'll have many more Kenyans also participating in that. To just give you a background, we had over 400 Kenyans go for iTech program just last year. So iTech is a very popular program. The other way we are helping, collaborating is in terms of evacuation of Kenyan nationals who are currently in India. You know, many of them go there for treatment of all kinds, cancer, elective operations, knee surgeries. There are all sorts of, because healthcare here is a little weak. So these Kenyans now have received their treatment for these other diseases and are now waiting to come back. So the Kenyan government requested us, and we have facilitated not only the approvals for the flights to take off from India and bring them back here, but also in terms of road transport, because these people are all over. They are in Coimbatore, they are in Chennai, Hyderabad, and the flight is going to take off just Delhi or Mumbai. So we need to get them all together. So we are helping them get the permissions to do the road transport. And lastly, on a medium-term basis, we are looking at collaborating with Kenya on the program called E-Arogya Bharati, which is actually a collaboration between hospitals through the internet, between both hospitals. So that is a more medium-term project.
So you talked about training of Kenyans on COVID. Is it specific to Kenya, or if you can answer this, that this is being expanded to rest of the African continent as well? Just a clarification and afterthought.
Yes. In fact, it is not only for Africa, it's also for SAARC countries. It's for all our partner countries. And iTech actually has over 100 partner countries. So they are, in fact, tailor-made. So it's very interesting and fascinating. We have actually gone to the extent of tailor-made, and they are in different languages. So, you know, so these courses are really, it's a great boon that we are having, and very timely. So I'm sure the Kenyan government will, you know, benefit from it, and so will the rest of the people.
So my next question is on the Indians in the country in Kenya. There are a number of Indians who are stranded there. So how is the Indian mission reaching out to them? Any plans of evacuation?
Firstly, since you mentioned, they are actually Indians stranded here. So that's one category. There are 100 in Nairobi, 150, over 150 in Mombasa, which is a port town in Kenya, and there are 5 in Somalia. So there are these 255, 260 Indians who are actually stranded, meaning they came here for tourism, or they came here for business, or to meet their relatives or friends or whatever, and now they can't go back. So for them, what we are doing is we have maintained a list. We are regularly in contact with them, talking to them, counseling them, advising them to, you know, sort of be calm and bear with all of us, bear with the country, bear with the world to beat this violent sort of issue. We are also helping them fill up the visa forms online from the Kenyan government side. So that is for the Kenyans who are stranded here. Then you said the Indian community that's here, there are 20,000 people who are Indian passport holders and about 60,000 people who are OCI card holders. So for those, I am doing video conference calls with the heads of the community associations. So I've done calls, and over 25 heads came online for this call, where we discussed the best practices, what are they doing, they shared their experiences. So just to give you an idea, the Gurdwara in Nairobi There are more than 20 Gurdwaras, by the way, just for a matter of interest for your viewers may be interested. But the one in Nairobi is giving hot meals to 400 people daily and dry rations to another 150 daily. That's just one Gurdwara here. Similarly, the Hindu community of Kenya, which is an umbrella organization, has been distributing 20,000 liters to the public of disinfectants and hand sanitizers, 50,000 liters to government and police personnel, two cubicles for testing COVID-19. So their chapter in, they have many chapters across the country, but just one example, their chapter in Nakuru actually fed 4,000 families last month. So this is what they are doing. Then to come to, like, just again, just give you a small example, there's a called the Lohana Samaj. You know, they actually are having a helpline for seniors. So they don't want the elderly people to go out and expose themselves. So, and this helpline is manned by youngsters, teenagers and youth. So it's inculcating a sense of service in them that, look, if you get a call on this helpline, you go out, shop and supply the thing to these elderly people. So it's a very good sort of way of training and upbringing to these people. So that community is doing that. So I wanted the other communities to hear what these communities are also doing so that each of them can share the practices. And then sort of coming to the other point, the OCI card holders. They're very prominent Indians here, like there's Mr. Narendra Rawal. So he's a very big businessman here. He's been donated a lot of money and he's now on the President Kenyatta's Emergency Response Fund. There's Mr. Bimal Shah, there's Dr. Manu Chandaria. These are all big, big businessmen here who are donating very generously to the President Kenyatta's fund. So when I briefed the minister, Minister Omamo, a few days back, I had a meeting with her. She was very happy with the Indian community support on this front. And now just two small instances to tell you where how the mission got involved. There was an Indian soldier from the Indian Army, actually in South Sudan, deployed in South Sudan. His flight was transiting via Nairobi. So it stopped in Nairobi and then he took off for Juba. Just as he landed in Juba, South Sudan closed their airspace and said, we are not taking any foreigners back. So he was put on the flight back to Nairobi. He landed here. Kenya said, we are not taking any foreigners. And meantime, India had closed its airspace. So now this poor Indian soldier was in no man's land. And so therefore, we stepped in, helped him. And just for your background, I mean, he's still here. And so we are sort of helping him. And so we are looking after him. Another small instance, an Indian held up in Malawi, again, with very weak infrastructure for medical assistance, needs some heart. So we got clearance for his aircraft to come as a medevac, come to Nairobi, get himself treated, and he's at the moment in a Nairobi hospital here, quite happy and well looked after.
These are interesting stories. Sir, talking about the medicines, we know you talked about the conversations which EM had with the Kenyan officials and the authorities. So how many quantities of medicines we have sent to Kenya, and are they expecting more in a sense?
Yeah, that's a good question. But before I come to that one, on the topic of medicines only, actually last week, over $1.5 million worth of medicines, HIV medicines, arrived just last week here. So the Kenyan government is very happy about it. This is a commitment made by Prime Minister Modi when he visited Kenya a few years back. So the medicines have been coming in tranches. So, but very welcome time it has arrived now. It's $1.5 million worth. But coming back to the telephone conversation of Dr. Jaishankar, so that is 379,000 tablets of hydroxychloroquine that they are purchasing from us, which we have allowed them to do. There are other APIs that they're also asking for permission. So we will be processing that and they are going to be able to get access those APIs from India. But it is not only medicines, you know, we are just focusing on the medical part of it. There are other aspects of it, which I'll just quickly mention to you. The Kenyan government has requested us for 1,000 tons of chlorine, calcium hypochlorite. So it is a water disinfectant. It's so critical in this period. So we are trying our best to sort of supply them with that. We'll probably give them as a grant, but we need to get suppliers and you know, the whole procedure of how to get it done. There is a locust issue going on at the moment here for the last several weeks. And the FAO's consignment of pesticide was coming from India and India declared a lockdown. All the trucks were held up. Again, the embassy had to step in and get them permission and passes. And all the pesticides have now arrived here and been delivered to the FAO to meet the locust men. And lastly, Exim Bank just gave them a loan a year and a half back to modernize their textile factory, which is the largest textile factory in East Africa, $30 million. That factory is today being used to produce thousands of masks, face masks. But it's a textile factory, so they are quite well aware of how to do this, so they are being used for that. So these are just the other ways in which it's not just medical help. I mean, there are other aspects also to it.
Mm-hmm. Another afterthought on the Indian community stranded. So if you can talk us through where they are, where they're kept, has the Indian mission put up some quarantine center or isolation center, as some missions are doing. So can you talk on that issue specifically?
No, there is that's a good question. But at the moment, there is no need to do that because there is nobody requiring that sort of quarantine facility at the moment. There's no Indian who's being infected and affected. But in anticipation of that, Indian community members have been encouraged and they have done it. They've gone and spoken to hospitals. They've gone and spoken to hotels. They've actually negotiated the rates that in case some people are requiring long-term quarantining and all that, what will be the facility available? What will be the procedure? How much? And one of the points I didn't mention in the earlier one, so I'm glad you brought it up here. Communities have also raised funds amongst themselves to keep money aside. So if somebody needs money and is admitted to these facilities because they're all on payment basis, they will pay out of these funds. So that is being done by the community. We are collaborating with them and they're doing a very good job on that.
So my last and final question to you is, what is the ground situation in Kenya and how are Indian diplomats faring? Because we have been talking to our diplomats in China, Iran, US, several countries, one of the most impacted countries. So are you facing any trouble on the ground or is it fine? Because there are countries as well where there is no problem.
No, the first case identified in Kenya was on 6th of March. So now 2 months later, we are at about 400 cases, so about 15 deaths. Of course, testing is limited, but they are ramping up testing and they are promising to really ramp it up a lot. But in the meantime, they have taken a lot of measures, like there's a night curfew. So 7 p.m. onwards, there's absolutely no exception, even diplomats, everybody is subject to a night curfew till 5 in the morning. So restaurants, bars, everything is shut at 7 o'clock in the night, malls and everything. No congregation, including religious congregation, banned. Schools, colleges, all suspended. They're all doing online sort of training. There is use of masks has become compulsory. So they've taken lots of measures. So we hope that they will be able to, you know, come out of it in a way because they had the experience of other countries going forward. Coming to your question about diplomats, we are actually taking full precaution, abundant precaution, maintaining social distance and still trying to keep up with our duties. So we are trying our best to sort of be ahead of the curve, monitor this evolving situation very closely and see what all we can do to counter it. Like, for example, at the moment, the visa wing is closed since we are having no visas there. So we are actually using the time to completely renovate that wing to make it more professional, more user friendly. All the Indian diplomats and spouses are feeling quite safe and comfortable. In fact, my wife has regular Skype calls with the wives of all the Indian officers here. So every 2-3 days, they catch up, they chat for an hour, hour and a half. I have Skype calls with them once in a while with the officers. So we exchange that to keep our morale up. So it is a tough situation, but I'm sure all of us will get out of it. Thank you.
Any best models from Kenya which we can adopt or perhaps any models we might have shared with the Kenyan government because we are doing globally, talking about various models like Bilwara model and other models in India?
The Kenyans are actively looking at all models across. So in fact, this idea of a curfew, they modified it to their this thing. They were very looking at our lockdown. And they said, look, if India, a country of 1.3 billion, can have a full lockdown, why can't we at least have a, you know, partial curfew zone? So because this is also a third world developing country. So they took that sort of intermediate step and they're quite strictly enforcing it. So in that sense, and also now this EITech COVID training, I'm sure they'll be picking up aspects of how to handle this situation out of there. So they very closely monitor what's happening in India and try and adapt it to their own situation here.
Well, thank you so much, sir, for that extensive talk. And the message from Delhi is stay safe. And of course, our missions globally are working in terms of tirelessly to make sure that the Indian communities are safe.
Thank you so much, Siddhant.